Hope you're all having a great day so far. My name is Matt. Nice to meet you. I really appreciate you guys coming tonight. So, quick show of hands. I want to know like how you guys are interested in survival. You guys like who goes camping? Any campers? Anybody like to go hiking? Mountain bikers? Anybody? Feel you? Any go fishing? Anybody go fishing? Anybody do crazy hardcore survival like on Naked and Afraid? Me neither. Good. That's a good thing. So a background real quick on me with the survival skills. So I've been doing the animal thing since I was like 8, professionally since I was 17. I'm not going to tell you how old I am now. But with the survival, I have an 8-year-old son. When right before he was born, I went to a professional survival training school in New Jersey, and I was there for a week doing a professional basic wilderness survival course, and was camping in the woods for a week with about 100 other people, and that was amazing. Huge experience for me. I went back when my son was about 3 years old for the advanced training course, also a week-long course, and that course was a lot different than the first one. That course, they take you to the roots of primitive survival, and you begin camping with these people in the woods, and you're in class 14, 16 hours a day with no breaks. And you've got your tent, your sleeping bag, and all that stuff, and your mess kit. They tell you by Wednesday, if you haven't made your own bowl and spoon out of wood, we're not going to let you eat. And they did. They locked up our mess kits. And you had to have your bowl. And my bowl was done Tuesday, thank you very much. But like Tuesday night, they made an announcement, you know, we're going to lock yours up in the morning. And everyone's around the fire trying to make their bowls real quick because they didn't think they were going to really do it. They said, if you don't build your debris hut made from sticks and leaves by Wednesday, we're going to take your tents and sleeping bags. We're going to lock them up. People didn't believe them. They actually did it. So thank goodness I had my debris hut built too. But by the end of the week, we were living fully primitively. Still in class, they still fed us and gave us water and stuff, but we were living in our huts, using our wood bowls or wood spoons, and teaching us edible plants, and we made bows that week, like the whole nine yards. It was amazing. So that's kind of my foundation for this. But I've always loved this stuff. When I was probably, 11 or 12, my dad bought me this book. You can tell how it's held together with packing tape. I mean, I read this thing over and over and over hundreds of times. This is Tom Brown's Field Guide to Wilderness Survival. It's always been my favorite book, still is, in my opinion, the best survival book ever written. I love it, and they may even have it at the library, I don't know. But I got this book, and I would be out in the backyard duplicating things from the book when I was like 11 or 12 every day. And now, since I've had this training, I'm even more obsessed. I mean, I brought a whole bunch of my paraphernalia that I've made with me here to show you guys afterwards. And I practice these things every day. And yeah, I'm a normal person. I have computers in the house and my Android phone and all that. But I practice these skills every day just because I love it and to help train myself and retain the information more. And it's just a lot of fun, too. It's a lot of fun playing in the woods. So these things don't need to be a big pain in the butt and not having, going without, that kind of thing. For me, it's just a ton of fun to practice the skills. So what I'm going to do with you guys is I'm going to do a few different things. We're going to go through the basics of wilderness survival at its rawest form, the primitive style. So that starting with nothing, assuming you have nothing, I'm going to tell you what to do anywhere in North America beginning from scratch. This is assuming you have no tools, no weapons, no clothing even, because you never know what's going to happen. Doesn't matter what season either. So we're going to talk about shelter, water, fire, and food, and also how to not get in that situation in the first place. Lost proofing, we call that. And then we're going to talk about what survival kits you can have and everyday carry items to have that may help you in an emergency. And then after all that, we're going to get into more of the thinking outside the box, how to make things. And I'll show you all the crazy things that I brought here that I've made, and I'll share that with you. So first off, we're going to start with shelter here. And I didn't bring anything with me because it's covered in snow. It's covered in a foot of snow right now. But basically, with shelter, you have to use whatever is around you. I like to do exercises in my mind wherever I am. Like if something happened right now, where I am right now, what could I use for things? And you start to like look around the room, look around wherever you are. And I'm the kind of person, I'm never bored. I get annoyed when people say they're bored. I've never been bored my whole life. My mind's always doing things, always playing little games. So like here in the library, if we had a blackout, lost power, we were snowed in, nobody can get out, what would you do in here to stay warm? Does anybody have an idea what you would do in here to stay warm? What do you think?
Burn books.
You'd burn books, yeah, but you might die too, so maybe not. But think about the books, right? I know like the librarians are going to be like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. No, not anything but the books. You can take the books, tear up the pages, crumple them up. That's insulation, right? That's dead airspace. What I would do is I'd be flipping over tables. You can have one table on top of you, lay a table against it, lay a table on that side, crawl in there, stuff the whole thing with crumpled up paper. You've got your own little insulated bed in there now, your own little cocoon. So that's a way to do this inside a house. You can stack mattresses one on top of the other and just go in between the two mattresses with the full mattress weight on you, and that'll insulate you. You can do all kinds of crazy things like that. You need to think outside the box with this. You know, smaller is better when you're keeping yourself warm. And you shouldn't always think about having to burn things because that's very inefficient. It's also, it takes a lot. You know, whenever you think you have enough to burn, it's not even close to what you're going to need for one night to burn, is what I've learned from doing this outside. So you need to think about just using your own body heat and making something that's super insulated. That's a much more efficient and easier way. So in the woods, the shelter that you build is called a debris hut. Anybody ever hear of a debris hut? No? It's the most efficient shelter in the world. It can be 30 below, snowing out, and you'll sweat inside this thing if you've made it correctly. And I've lived inside one for a week at survival training. I used to have one on the side of my house. I had it there for about 2 weeks, slept in it a couple times, and then my ex-wife got mad, and that wasn't there anymore. But now, that is not the reason why, okay? It's not the reason why. So now I have a survival camp back in the woods, away from all the houses, and I have a debris hut back there. But I've stayed in it a bunch of times, and it really, really is that good. I've been in there where it's pouring outside, not a drop of water goes inside it. I've been there in the snow, below freezing. You'll sweat inside it, and I have sweated inside it. And you can go in there without any clothing on, no jacket, nothing, no socks, no shoes, and you'll sweat if you've done it correctly. So the basics of what you do for the shelter is, you guys ever look up in the trees this time of the year, and you'll see in like a big oak tree, it's bare, but there'll be a big ball of leaves up in there. You ever see those? You know what those are? The squirrel nest, right. So you're doing basically what the squirrels do. If you climbed up there and looked at this thing and cut it in half, they make a frame with the sticks, and then they weave these leaves all around it so it's windproof and waterproof. You can dump a 5-gallon bucket of water over that, not a single drop goes in there on the squirrel. And then they stuff the whole inside with leaves, and they've got an entrance on the side to the bottom, kind of. And the inside for the squirrel is only about that big enough for them to curl up in a ball. That's it. They heat it with their body. Up in the tree and the wind swaying in the rain, and they're warm as can be in there. So we're doing the same thing, but human-sized. So you make like an exaggerated tripod. You make, you know, like two sticks on the ground about this high, and then one very, very long one, so you can lay inside this thing. Then you put smaller sticks on the sides like ribbing. Pile leaves on the top. How many leaves? You should be in up to your armpit before you feel the sticks you put in there. That's how much leaves. And that's if it's about 30 degrees Fahrenheit. If it's below freezing, like way below, you might need 5 or 6 feet of leaves on that thing. And then once you've got the leaves on the top, you're not done, because what you've created is like a tent, basically. You guys ever sleep in a tent but no sleeping bag?
Yeah.
I have. It sucks. Okay? You'll freeze. You'll still be shivering. So you've made your tent, basically. You need to shove leaves on the inside, too. That is like your sleeping bag. That's the real key there to keeping you warm. The outside just keeps the wind, the rain, and snow off you. So the whole inside needs to be shoved full of leaves also. If you want to see a how-to video on how to do this, I made a video on my YouTube channel, Animal Man Survivor. I've got like 3,000 subscribers so far. I have a debris hut video on there if you guys wanted to watch it. If you want to subscribe, that'd be awesome too. But I've got a lot of cool videos. I've got like 120 or 130 videos on there so far. But that's the basics of the debris hunt, okay? But that concept you use anywhere, like I said, here in the library, make the same thing at your home, same thing. Use pillows, use blankets, use mattresses, whatever you have, whatever you want to use. So shelter is the most important. After that comes water, okay? So we're going to talk about water. And the goofy thing about water is in a lot of cases, even though water is more important than fire, sometimes you need fire to purify your water. So you kind of need both. You have to work on both. And when I'm doing my survival, because I go out for the weekend with just a knife several times a year, when I'm practicing this, in the beginning when I first did it, I get all hung up on the shelter, and then before I know it, it's like the evening, and I'm like, oh, I haven't had a drink all day, you know, I haven't got my fire, and then it's dark out, and you're like out of luck, and you have to just wait till the next day. What you've got to get in the habit of is multitasking, which I bet a lot of you have to do at work and things like that. So you have to kind of work on shelter as you're working on the fire, as you're working on purifying your water and making your bowl and stuff like that. Okay? So what you do for the water is you really can't trust any water sources around here. There are springs, but they're few and far in between. And you don't know if a mouse just came up and took a poop in the spring. You don't know that. Okay? Mice poop are tiny. So I don't trust anything. I mean, the only wild water source that I'll trust is dew, because it just got there that day. In the morning, there's dew on the branches. You can take a sock, you can take your shirt, you can take a bandana, wipe it on the pine needles or whatever it is. Make sure you're not wiping it on poison ivy or anything like that, you know? You don't want to drink poison ivy water. But you can do that, and then you squeeze the sock on your hand with your thumb like that, and it's like a spigot right into your mouth. And it's distilled, purified water. You just want to make sure there's no bird poop on the leaves you're getting it from, that's all, okay? No poison ivy, no bird poop, that's all. Aside from that, you've got to boil the water. That's the key. But to boil the water, you have to have some kind of vessel, and if we don't have a metal canteen with us, which we should, then we have to use wood or clay or something. And wood's a lot easier to work with than clay for most people. So I'm gonna teach you how I made this bowl. I made this bowl at my week-long advanced survival course that I took in New Jersey. This is the bowl that I made that week, and I ate out of all week. I purified water with this. I ate my stews out of it and everything. This is from a cedar log. I carved this from a cedar log. And what you do is, I could carve this with my knife or a rock if I had to, and spend days doing it, or I can use my time wisely and let coals from the fire do the carving for me and go do something else and save my energy, save my muscles, save my time. So this is called coal burning. You use the coals to carve the wood out for you, basically. So what you do is when you have your fire, I'll get to the fire after, but assuming you have a fire, you take the coals and you make some kind of tongs out of pieces of wood or a piece of bark or whatever. You drop some coals on top of the log. And you can just walk away and leave them there, and the wind will blow on them a little bit. Or, I don't know what the heck I did with it. I had a little piece of Japanese knotweed that I used as a straw. But you can find a cattail or a reed or a piece of Japanese knotweed, or bamboo grows around here now too, though. Any of those that's hollow, you can use like a straw and blow on the coals, and that makes them char this faster. So it chars the wood. Once it's charred, you dump the coals back in the fire, take a sharp rock or your knife, scrape the charred out, and then put new coals back on there and repeat it. This is a rock that I threw against another rock to make it break off to have an edge. And this is my scraper to make these bowls. This is what I scraped the charred wood out with, okay? And then once you got this depression big enough, I mean, once I got this about the size of my fist, then I can start using it. It's not done yet, but then it's big enough that I can start to purify just a little bit of water so I can actually just have a steak and drink finally. So then I would put water in there from the swamp or your lake or your river or whatever you have, and then I take a hot rock from my fire. And I have like golf ball sized rocks that I drop in there, and you get them red hot, pick them up with a piece of bark or pieces of sticks or whatever, drop them in there. One golf ball sized rock, if this thing was full of water, one rock brings this to a boil instantly. That's how fast that is. And then I boil that for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever you want. And then take the rock out, throw it back in the fire to use it again later, let this cool. When it's cool enough, you drink your water, fill it back up, do it again until you're not thirsty anymore. Then once I'm not thirsty, then I can start dumping coals back in here, finishing this out, making this bigger. But then, after that, I can start collecting edible plants, throwing them in here. If you find little worms or grubs or whatever you want to eat, things like that, throw them in there, make yourself a stew. Now you're eating and drinking at the same time. So now you're multitasking again. So that's the way you do this. You guys can pass this around, check it out if you want. So that's how that's done, basically. Here's a mug that I made the same way, also cedar. Took me 3 tries to get it right because I kept on burning a hole through the side of it. It's hard to do it when it's this small, but you can pass that around too. It's kind of neat. And then here's the spoon that I made. I never quite finished it, but this is made from black walnut. This is the spoon that I used with that bowl for the week when I was in survival camp. You guys can pass that around too. The same thing, you carve it, basic shape with your knife, and then you use the coals to burn the depression in the spoon. And that's how you make the spoon. And then here's just one more example of how you can make a bowl. Not with coal burning. Another favorite technique of mine is to use tree bark. And I know everyone always talks about birch bark, this birch bark, that birch bark. Birch bark is a pain in the butt to deal with because it splits very, very easily. This is from a pine tree. I mean, how often do you see a pine tree around here, right? They're everywhere. They're everywhere. And the bark's easier to work with. It's very, very pliable. This is the outer and the inner bark together. And I'll strip it from a live branch. And you can fold it up. I take little sticks, I split them, and I tie string around the base of it so that they don't split all the way in half. I use them like clothespins, fold the corners up, clothespin them in place. You can use this right away. After you're done, if you leave it like that, it dries out and hardens. It's like hard as a rock now. And you can keep on using that over and over and over again as a bowl. So I've used that bowl multiple times too to cook my stews and everything on survival weekends. Does anybody have any questions about that? Anything that I've said so far? How do you get that off the tree? I take a knife and I score it. There's a technique called batoning, because I can take a knife. This is my favorite one that I use all the time. This is called a T2 tracker knife. It's made by Topps Knives. This is the one that I carry on me the most often. You could take this and hack the heck out of the tree, but you're not going to hit the same spot each time. It's going to be a hack job, and it's more tiring, and the more tired you get, I might slip and hurt myself. So what you do is, it's called batoning. You'd find a stick, and I'd use this like a little hatchet. I'd choke back on the grip like this, and I would have chopped this branch off. And now you've got like a little club. You can use this for self-defense. You can use this as a throwing stick to hunt with. But I also use this to work on projects around camp. So if I'm on that tree, I want to cut out a square of that bark. So I line this up, and I just go tap, 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 tap. It's like you're perforating it, almost like a check in a checkbook. Tap, 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 tap across the top. And then I would take this and wiggle it underneath and pry it off like this is a spatula. Once I get the corner up, I can slide my fingers underneath and real quick I go and it's off in like less than a minute. Very, very fast. So that's how you would do that. And if it's a live tree, I try to use a branch or I use a big enough tree that I just take a square off the side. Because if you go all the way around the tree, you girdle the tree and it cuts off the sap and you'll kill the tree. And I'm very, very careful about not killing plants if you don't need to, that kind of thing. So that's what you do. Now for fire is cool. Everybody loves fire. We're going to talk about bow drill. You guys know what the bow drill is? Some people call it the Bowen drill. All right. So there's 4 basic parts of the bow drill. Got the bow. Everyone knows there's a bow in the bow drill. All this is a piece of a pine branch, and this is parachute cord, like it's on my bracelet. What you can use, if you don't have this, you can use a shoelace. Shoelaces can work. You can use part of your leather belt. You can use animal hide from a roadkill animal or something like that. You can use a rootlet from a pine tree or a spruce tree. You can use all kinds of things for that. And then you've got the fireboard, which is the part that goes in the bottom, the handhold, and you've got the spindle. Okay. So I'm not going to get really technical on everything, but the gist of it is it's a friction fire. Okay. All the primitive methods, most of them at least, have to do with friction. And you guys ever watch the cartoon animated Frosty the Snowman, the really old one? All the woodland critters are like in the woods with that character Karen, and she's like shivering, and they're like trying to make her a fire to warm her up, right? And the guy goes, pretty soon there was a spark, and you see the creatures going like this, all of a sudden it goes, and it like bursts into flames. I can't watch movies like that with people because I freak out. I'm like, it's not like that. That's not how it works. It's not really like that. My wife used to get so mad at me when I would be like, she can't watch movies with me at all. So what really happens is, yeah, I could do this, but I'd be doing this all day, and then it would just be like warm to the touch. You're not going to get a fire like that. It's very, very difficult, okay? This would have to be much longer, very specific types of wood. There'd have to be a groove carved on here for that to work. So what you have to think of, instead of being like this, is you want all the heat in one spot. So it's like this. See the difference? All the friction is concentrated in one spot, and this will work very, very quickly. So you've got the fireboard. I'll use this to show you. Fireboard, spindle, handhold to keep that where you want it. And then the bow bows it back and forth. And you don't go like this like you're playing a violin or something. You go like, you wrap it around one time, lock it on there, and then it will turn when you bow back and forth. I'll show you guys real quick on the floor. I don't want to the library on fire or anything. You're welcome. You guys enjoy all the survival food back there, by the way? I smelled it when I walked in the door. I'm like, that doesn't smell very survival-y. Hopefully the camera can see me on the floor. Can you see me on the floor?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm right-handed. So I kneel on my right knee. I'm going to use my left foot for this, and I usually take my shoes off so I can feel what I'm holding onto the board. But my favorite technique is not to use a flat piece of wood. This is the way that I was taught to carve it flat, so you understand the technique. But realistically, if I had to carve something like this before it even gets started making the fire, it'll take me all day. And you don't have all day. If you need a fire, you need a fire like now. You need a fire like yesterday, you know? So what you do is you learn techniques to save time and energy. One way is to take two sticks, tie them together, and just drill right down the middle. And this is pretty much the same thing. Because if you look at this, I've got a hole on the edge and I've got a little notch, like a pizza slice cut out. And that notch collects the sawdust from this, and then it heats up into a coal. Then I've got a little coal the size of a pencil eraser. Now this is cheating. So now I've got there, it's like I have two built-in notches. If I do this, more often than not, I'll get a coal on each side. I'll get two coals. So it's like less work and you get two coals. It's like, who wouldn't want to do that, right? So I hold this under my foot, pin it down, because you don't want this to move at all. Because once you start getting sawdust, the worst thing that can happen is if it moves, your sawdust just goes everywhere. And usually on this, one side will be thicker. The thicker side always goes down. And I wrap it around there once, get that in the hole, have my handhold ready, put it on there, and I'm going to start to bow back and forth. I'm not going to do it a lot because it starts to smoke fast. Already got smoke. I don't know if you guys saw that. You'll probably smell it in a minute. Oh, I smell it. Smell the cedar. But that's how fast it is, and then you end up getting a coal on each side. Then, party's not over yet, then you have to have a tinder bundle you've already gotten together beforehand, dump the coal in there, wrap it up, blow it into flame, and then you have your fire. Hopefully we won't set the smoke alarm off. I tried to not do it. But you guys can check all this stuff out when you come up here after. So that's the technique for the bow drill. Anybody have any questions about what I talked about with the bow drill? Yes?
How'd you make the little... You said drill. Mm-hmm. Like, what do you mean drill?
The technique is called the bow drill because you're like drilling that down into the wood.
How did it get the holes in it? Like,
these holes are from me making fires with these.
Okay, so you don't actually drill it. You just use the sticks, and then it will make the
holes. To make this whole kit, all the parts of this kit, all you need is a knife or a sharp rock. Sharp rock takes 3 times longer than a knife does, which is why I should carry a knife outside. But sometimes I will start the hole. If I keep trying to start it and it slides around like a maniac, I'll take a knife and I'll just abrade a little bit just to keep it in there. But real quick, this starts to make a hole within about maybe 10 rotations, you know. It starts to drill down into that. Any other questions about it? No?
Okay.
makes for a good drum? What kind of wood?
Yeah, a medium hardwoods. You don't want anything super soft. You don't want anything super hard. Like, you don't want to use oak or hickory. A maple is pretty good. Cedar is great. Cedar is awesome. And a lot of times, now that I've experienced this a lot, I choose different woods for different things on purpose because it makes it easier. Like, this hand holds black walnut because it's harder. You don't want this to burn through. You want this to not burn, right? So you want a harder wood for this if you have a choice. You can use one branch to make every single part of this if you want to be fast, but if I have a choice, I'll use a harder wood for this because it doesn't burn. And you can lubricate this too. You can lubricate this with soap, chapstick, Vaseline. You can use grease from your ear or your nose or your forehead, just a little bit so it doesn't burn, lubricates it a little bit. That'll work. Cedar works great for the fireboard. This is just an extra cedar shingle from a house. And I use these to practice on. I have a whole box of these that I use for tinder in my fireplace and in my wood stove. But cedar shingles, if you know somebody with cedar shingles, they have extra shingles, grab a few. They're great to practice on. Now these are all called yucca. Anybody know what yucca is? Not yucca you buy in the supermarket or Whole Foods. It's different yucca. These are a plant that is not native to here. It's native to the Southwest U.S. and deserts. But it's been brought here as like an ornamental. A lot of landscaping companies use it. And they've naturalized. So you can find them on the side of the road. You can find them in office parks, near stores. They look like they belong in the desert. They look almost like an aloe vera plant. They have, you may have seen these on the side of the road. They have long, they're evergreen. They've got long, sword-like leaves. And they grow in like a rosette. Anybody see these things? They're all over the place. I see them everywhere. You can use the leaves to make string. You can make bowstrings out of it even. That's how strong the fibers are. The roots you can make soap out of. The flower stalks, when they dry, make the best spindle material I've ever seen. It's got a pith in the middle, which burns very, very easily. It was hard on the outside. These make an awesome spindle. And then if it's a large enough yucca plant, I can break one flower stalk off, use the thicker pieces to tie together to make these, and use the top part for the spindles. And that's what these all are. They're yucca. You can also use mullein, which grows around here, if anybody knows what mullein is. You can look these up in my books up there after if you want. You can pass that around. So now, I'm just going to show this to you. I'm not going to demo it because I will definitely set the library on fire. We're going to talk about flint and steel, which normally is not in this course, but I wanted to show you guys some extra things today because we've got some extra time tonight. These are flint and steel kits that I put together. This is an Altoids tin. They're great for many, many things, many survivally things. This is a tin from my dog's breath mints. and there's two different ways to do this. So has anybody ever seen those flint and steel? They're called ferrocerium rods, but it's like a flint and steel rod, and you strike it, and you get a shower of sparks. You guys see those? They sell them like Sports Authority, Dick's, EMS, REI. They're great for an emergency fire starting thing. This is like the old school real flint and steel version before those things were created. So this is what they used to do all over Europe to start fires. You've got a piece of high carbon steel. The best steel for this is old wood files. I go to yard sales, flea markets. I find them in the woods a couple times. And I get old files. And I put them in my vise and I whack them with a hammer. And they're so high carbon, they just snap in half. And I can get three or four of these out of one file. This is the best for striking sparks. And then you have some type of rock. This is a type of white flint called Keokuk. But around here, we have quartz cobblestones everywhere. And they work just as great. I mean, this here, this is a quartz cobblestone from my son's parking lot in his preschool that I picked up next to my car. This will strike awesome sparks. Anybody have geodes at home? You know what geodes are? A lot of kids have them. Geodes make awesome sparks. The sparks go like fireworks. They're great. So you've got the steel, the sharp rock, and you've got this. This is char cloth. All char cloth is 100% cotton, either an old t-shirt, old bed sheets, old underwear, whatever. You cut it into little squares to fit your tin, stack them up, close it, throw this on the campfire or on the grill for a couple minutes, and it'll start to smoke. And when the smoke stops, you take it off. And what it does is, because this is closed and the oxygen can't get in there, it chars it, but it won't burn it. You end up with char cloth, which is very, very combustible and catches a spark very, very easily, and it spreads. So you'd have your tinder bundle of light, fluffy material ready, and I would take my rock, find a sharp edge, put this either on top of it or on the bottom. I prefer to put it on top. People think the sparks only go one way. When you spark this, it goes every which way. It doesn't matter. And I hold it there, and I get my fingers out of the way, and I strike this with a circular kind of glancing motion, like this. I'm going to get this out of the way so I can spark it for you and not set it on fire. See that? See how they go up and down every which way? Doesn't matter where the cloth is. It's going to catch one. So sparking great today. I love when it works. I've noticed that if it's very, very humid out, it's hard to get this started. The humidity affects the char cloth a lot. So just keep that in mind. This is another version, which I'd never seen anybody do. I kind of came up with this. I'm sure I'm not the inventor of it or whatever, but I haven't seen it done before with anyone except for me. This is cotton rope that I got at Joann Fabrics on clearance. I bought like 6 feet of this stuff. I was like, this is going to be such a cool experiment. So I curl it up in here, and I keep the steel and the rock in there. When I want to make a fire, I stick just the charred end out. And just like before, instead of the char cloth, you have that. Put the rock on top, strike down on it. That catches. Put the tinder bundle against it, blow it into flame. When I'm done, pop that back inside the tin. When I close it, it goes out. Use it over and over and over again. Really a lot of fun. So you can make yourself little kits. Become a pyromaniac for sure. It's addicting. And I've got all different fire steels that I've made because I do some blacksmithing over here. So you guys can check them out after. Any questions about the flint and steel or anything about fire? No? Okay. Let's see. Did fire, did water. Talk about food real quick. I've got some of my favorite plant books that I brought from home. You guys can check them out later, you know, write them down or take photographs of them if you want. Those are my recommendations to learn plants. When I went to my first basic wilderness survival course in New Jersey, a big part of it was learning wild edible plants and medicinal plants. And I'll be honest with you, I did not give a rip about learning plants. I wanted to learn about cool stuff. I wanted to make fires. I wanted to build a bow and arrow, all that cool like guy stuff. I did not care about plants. And I totally blew off all the plant lectures. I was like texting my wife and stuff in the woods, and I was like watching the birds make a nest and stuff. I just did not care. And I was driving home, and I was thinking to myself, like, I was all excited about what I learned that week, and I was like, what am I gonna do first? And everything that I thought I wanted to do, I realized that it would be helpful if I knew plants, because plants, you need plants to make everything. You need to know what plants to make your fire, to know how to make your bow drill kit, what trees to use for wood, what kinds of wood. I wanted to make a bow. I have to ID the right trees to make the bow. For trapping, it's like every skill that I came up with that I wanted to try, I realized that I screwed up and I need to know plants for. So when I teach this, I kind of make a big point of saying that plants form the core of all of this. Learning the plants, there's no excuse not to. If you learn the plants, you realize that you use them for everything. Everything. Your shelter, the water, the fires, the whole nine yards, you need plants for. So if you want to learn plants, what I tell people is to do what I did. Hopefully, if you take a plant course, you don't blow it off like I did. Because I had to then learn everything myself without an instructor. And putting in all this extra time when I could have had it, you know, like that quickly, having somebody show it to me. And I had that, but I ignored it and wasted it. So if you're learning it yourself, what I say is to get 3 good plant books. And all these ones are ones I consider good plant books. And get 3 of them. And that way, if you decide you want to learn like a pine tree, you cross-reference. So you look up that pine tree in all 3 books, lay them open, cross-reference, make sure they all match, the descriptions, the pictures, everything matches. Make sure you've got the right plant, everything's good. That way, if one of the books had been wrong, you have the other ones to fall back on, and you're not going to just rely on that one that could be wrong and you could get sick or poisoned or whatever. Does that make sense? So you need 3 of them. And that's how you don't screw up, basically. And I've never misidentified a plant and gotten sick before, and I'm very, very proud of that because I'm very, very careful with this stuff. So that's how you learn the plants. Now, with the plants, there are the top four. When I was in my survival course, when I learned this, they called that the Big Four. I call it the Fantastic Four, you know, because I like superheroes and stuff. I call it the Fantastic Four of plants. So these are the top four to know, because they can do the most for you. They're very versatile. You can use them any season of the year, and they all have food, medicine, things like that, and you can use them anywhere. And most of these grow all over North America. I mean, you can walk and find at least two or three of these anywhere in North America, which is significant. It's important. So we've got grass, you know, like mowing the lawn grass. Grass is one of them to know. Oak trees are one of them. Pine trees and cattails. Okay? Those are the big four to know. Food and medicine from all of them all year. Pretty cool. So that's all I'm going to say about the plants. You guys can look through those books and ask me questions about it after. Anybody have any questions about it? No? Okay. I do have a couple things I'll pass around. Don't open these. This is just a pine cone. A lot of people have trouble identifying. There are all different evergreens around here. That's from an actual pine tree, which is the edible one. This is ground up acorns to make acorn flour. You can make pancakes or bread out of that. It's pretty good. This is pollen from cattails. You can harvest cups and cups of this very, very easily in the springtime. And then this is flour made from cattail roots. You can pass this around too. You can also make pancakes or bread from that. Yeah?
Well, if you were to walk out of the library right now and you were hungry, what natural could you eat?
The fastest, easiest, most common thing to find around here right now, even with the snow, is pine bark. Mm-hmm. Pine bark is a superfood. The inner bark. So I would take my knife, you walk up to a pine tree, take your knife, put it up against it, scrape a strip straight down, pull it off the tree, and you take the white inner bark off the inside. Do you guys ever hear of the Adirondack Indians in New York? You know what Adirondack means? It means bark eaters, because their staple food all year was pine bark. I mean, you could survive for months just eating pine bark and nothing else. It has everything your body needs in it. You're going to be constipated, but that's a different story. So, yeah, pine bark is where it's at for sure. When I practice my survival skills, I figure out real quick when I'm trying to multitask, before I even know where my camp is going to be, I start collecting things. Like right off the bat, I'm shoving edible plants and leaves and stuff in my pockets, and they get full. And then I'm finding like tinder, and I'll find like a deer antler or an animal bone I want to use to make something. And so what I started doing was I started making baskets right away. This is one of the first baskets that I made. I made this on one of my first survival outings by myself for the weekend with just a knife. This is grapevines that I found in the woods, and I made this. I call this my eagle nest. Probably 8 years ago I made this. And I use it to carry my stuff for all my programs that I do. So you make something like this, you whip this up real quick, and you make this in probably 20 or 30 minutes, depending on how particular you're going to be. And I have little handles I put on there, and you can carry all your stuff with you to make it easier. You can pass that around, guys. Survival basket. This one is also made from grapevines, much smaller. You can pass that around. And then this one is my favorite. This is made from willow, which is my favorite basket making material. This one's really cute, I like it. So you can pass that around, it's got a little handle. So I can walk around the woods all cute with my little basket. And what I do with the willow is, this time of the year is great to harvest it when there's no leaves. And you just cut these off. These are all the things that hang down, the yellow things that hang down. You cut them off. And I wrap them up like this in a ball, let them dry, and I let them harden. And when I'm ready to make a basket out of them, I dump this in a 5-gallon bucket of water and soak it like overnight, and it makes it pliable again. Then you make your basket, and then it'll re-harden again. So I dry it first, because when you dry it the first time, it shrinks. You don't want to make the basket out of branches you just picked, because then your whole basket shrinks and loosens up everything. So you want this to dry it the first time, and then when you rehydrate it, it doesn't get bigger and shrink again. It only shrinks the first time. So I just wanted to mention that. Okay. Does anybody know what the most important thing to have is with you in the woods in case of an emergency? Like survival-wise. A knife, yes. Almost nobody gets that right. I'm very, very impressed. A knife. Yeah. So a knife is the most important tool. The reason why it's the most important tool is because, think about this. You can use this one tool to then manufacture everything else you could possibly need from it. That's why it's the most important. This is for self-defense. You can cut things to make your shelter. You can use this to work on your bowl and your spoon, to cut plants, to fillet an animal or a fish if you have to make your fire kit, all different things you make from your knife. Yes, sir?
If you didn't have access to a knife, what would be the best natural material?
If you didn't have access to a knife, the best natural materials are stones and also antler and bone. To me, antler and bone are better because you sharpen them by grinding them on a rock very, very fast. They can become razor sharp, and they're pretty durable. And if they crack or chip, you just grind them down again. And you keep it's like resharpening a knife, but you have to do that more often because it's not as hard. The stones, if you make a stone tool like this, this is a flint cutting blade that I made. Okay, it's rounded on this side so I can hold it. If I drop this on the ground one time and it hits something hard, it snaps in half and it's done. So stones are cool to work with. People tend to think that most of the knives and arrowheads Indians used were made of stone because that's what's in museums, but that's not the case. The only reason they're in the museums is because the antler and the bone and the wood tools rotted and they're not around anymore. They were the most common. They were the most durable, the fastest to make, and they lasted longer when you're using them. These are a pain in the butt to make, and if you drop them or you hit them against something hard, they just chip and break apart, and you have to start all over. And it would take several hours to make something like this, okay? So nowadays, you know what? I mean, I hate finding it, but everywhere I go in the woods, I find trash. I find plastic and metal, and I find glass. If you find a glass Snapple bottle or a beer bottle, I grab it, because I can take the bottom of that beer bottle and make an arrowhead in about 10 minutes, or make a knife in 10 minutes from that glass bottle. So you can use that as a resource. You guys can pass some of these around. I'll pass these two around. This one, be careful, this one will really cut you. This one is sharp. This is made from obsidian, which makes the sharpest blades on the planet. Top surgeons across the world use this rock for their scalpel blades because it has less scarring. This is goldstone. I made both of these. This is a spear point. This is just an arrowhead that I made. And pass, I'm going to give you that one. Give you guys that one. Grab these back. And there's a specific technique to flint knap to make those, which I don't have time to get into today. If anybody wants to after, you can ask me and I'll tell you about it after. So, a knife is the most important. Aside from a knife, if I had a choice of what to carry, I'd carry a parachute cord, which is what's on my bracelet, so I have this with me every day. This is military parachute cord. It's also called 550 cord. People also call it paracord. It holds 550 pounds, and it has an outer sheath that holds 200, and then it has 7 inner strands. Each of those holds 50. So if you want to use it for something, you cut a section of it off, you can pull the inner strands out and use them for bowstrings, traps. You can use it for fishing lines, sewing, all kinds of cool things. And you get more and more string if you pull it apart. You can even take those 50-pound strands and unwind them to get even thinner and thinner strands. So that's pretty useful to have. And then I would have a stainless steel water bottle. You know, a lot of us, when we're outdoors anyway, we carry water with us. Why not make it a stainless steel one? Because, well, two reasons actually. Number one, you run out of water, you can fill this up with whatever gross water you find. If you have a fire source, make a little fire, throw that on there, boil the water, purify your water. You have an endless supply of purified water now, because you have this bottle. You don't have to make a wood bowl or whatever, okay? Other thing, which people don't think of, if this is full of water, this is an impact self-defense weapon. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Can you imagine if you had a Poland Spring bottle and someone's trying to attack you in the woods or whatever, no one's around and you whack them with it and it bounces off and they laugh at you and get mad, okay? But if you bean somebody with this, you'll knock them out. You really knock them out, okay? It's like concussion time with this. So it's another benefit to having a stainless steel bottle. And then you're reusing things and not putting all the bottles in the recycling plant or in the trash or whatever. Okay. So also you should have some way to start a fire, I believe. And you know what? Might as well say this too. The most important thing, aside from a knife to have with you, is your phone. Especially if it's a smartphone, if it's like an Android or an iPhone or something. Police can GPS locate you if you report it missing. They can, even if your phone is not on, they can get pings from your phone and locate you if you're unconscious or whatever, God knows whatever happened. But your cell phone. I also have survival apps on here. I have like edible plant apps. I have GPS, compass apps. I have a night vision app on here. I have metal detector. I have all kinds of crazy things on here just because I can. And they're fun. So you should have your phone. And while I'm talking about this, anytime you're going out in the woods, and I struggled with this for a long time, anytime you're in the woods, you have to tell somebody where you're going. But not just tell them. When I was in college, I'd go hiking up in the mountains by myself because no one at school with me liked to do these things that I like to do. So I'd go out by myself. And my dad would always be like, he'd find out that I went, and he'd be like, did you tell anybody where you're going? And I'm like, no. I'm like, stop giving you a hard time, Dad. And I'd get mad at him. And I didn't realize until I was older that he was trying to protect me, you know? And he'd say to me, when I was in my dorm, he'd say to me, don't just tell somebody where you're going. I don't know these people. You have to write it down and tell them you wrote it down. So he'd say that because, like, if I got lost or didn't show up and I had told my friend, you know, if they're looking for me and the police are involved or whatever and I'm missing, people, they can't remember. Like, they get stressed out. They're like, I don't know what time he said, and I don't know what trail he said, and, oh, I'm not sure. I think he said this, but I don't really know. And they have no idea where to look for you, how long you've been gone for. So you write it down, and you tell somebody, and you write it down, or you text it to them so they have it in writing or that kind of thing. Makes sense, right? So this is what I tell everybody that I teach, same thing. Another cool thing, which I learned in Cub Scouts, of all places, when I was like 8 years old. This is kind of a cool thing we used to do in Cub Scouts. Whatever shoes you're going to wear when you go hiking, you take a piece of aluminum foil, you put it on a carpet, you take your shoes and you step on it. And it makes perfect impressions of the soles of your shoes. And you keep that at your house with your note of where you're going to be hiking and the times and what trails or whatever. That way, if they have to look for you, they have imprints of what your tracks are going to be like. Pretty awesome, right? So that's a cool trick there, too. Okay, so we're going to talk about, before I get to that, we'll talk about EDC. You guys know what EDC means? You know what that stands for? A lot of survival and like preparedness people always talk about EDC items, and what that stands for is everyday carry. Things that you have on your person at all times, except if you're like at the beach in your bathing suit, okay? Then it's tough. Then I struggle with that. But there's things that I carry on me all the time. And if you look at me, all you really see that I have on me for survival is like this bracelet. But some people notice that's a parachute cord survivally thing. Other people just see a bracelet. Other people don't even notice. But this is all you would see. I have several things on me, though, at all times. Okay? I always have, I'm going to take this thing off. In this pocket, this is my Zippo lighter, and I don't smoke. I carry this because I like to play with fire. And I'm always working on projects. You know, when I'm making my bracelets here, if you ever made one of these, you know once you tie it off on the end, you have to melt the end so it doesn't come undone, right? I work on these when I'm in the car between shows like this sometimes. So I use this to melt the ends. I use this if I'm working on making my arrows. I make primitive arrows. Sometimes I use pine sap to attach the arrowhead onto the arrow shaft. You melt the pine sap and then it hardens when it cools. I use that to melt the pine sap sometimes. So I'm always using it for projects, and then I have the added benefit of if I have an emergency, I have that, or whatever. So I have that. This is the thing that I use every day, my Leatherman. Anybody have a Leatherman? I used to carry around this knife that you pull it out, and you go like that, and it like switchblades out. And my ex-wife would always be like, don't take that out in public, it looks weird. People are gonna look at you funny, they're gonna think you're like a gangster or something. So I kinda thought about it, and I was like, you know what, she's giving me a hard time about it. And I have something better anyway, because all that has a knife, this has a whole toolbox in it. So this is even better. So this has the knife, which I use all the time. Pliers I use almost every day for all kinds of things. And these have a spring to it. This is the Leatherman Wingman. This is my favorite one. And get this at sporting goods shops, Home Depot, and Lowe's sell it. It should be about $35 probably. I've carried this same Leatherman on me for like 4 years now. Every day for 4 years. So it's got that. It's got bottle opener. It's got screwdriver. This is kind of cool. It's got a package opener. Those hard plastic packages that you cut your fingers on trying to open. It's great for those. Not survivally, but still cool. More screwdrivers. And then it's got a great pair of scissors. I love these scissors too. Nice sharp scissors. So I use that almost every day for things. And I always have that in my pocket. And these are my special survival pants. I wear these every day. They're from Bass Pro Shops. They're tactical pants. They have lots of pockets because I love pockets. And that's like my knife pocket. This little thing is my cigarette lighter pocket, cell phone pocket. And then in here, I'll just show you everything I have. In here, I have two little tins. This one I have hand cream in, especially in the winter. But what I do with my hand cream is I put a candle wick in the middle. Oh, because this is very, very flammable. So if I needed to, hand cream. If I needed to, I can take my lighter and light that wick and I've got a candle. I haven't even figured out how long this can burn for. It'll burn for a while. And so I've got that as a candle. Or if I want to save my lighter fuel, I can use this to work on a project with for the fire source. And here, I've got the Burt's Bees chapstick. I could get it in the plastic chapstick thing, but I prefer the tin because I can also use this for fuel. I can stick that wick in here, then burn this if I have to. I can use this to lubricate my bow drill spindle or whatever I'm working on. And I can do it that way too. So I always carry those. And then I have survival kits everywhere. My keychain, let me show you my keychain, guys. Where is it? You're not gonna be able to see it all. I'm not gonna pass it around either. But I have a survival kit in my wallet, survival kit on my keychain. At some point, I'm gonna make a survival belt, probably. I'll be like Batman. It'll be the coolest thing ever. So this, this is my survival section. Actually, that's my survival section. It's smaller. Not as bad, right? So I've got this little key that comes off. And it's a knife. It's a key knife. It's got a little eyeglass screwdriver on there. Little pair of pliers there, bottle opener, screwdriver, a little serrated blade too. So I've got a cutting tool. Also, I've got one of those ferro searing rods that I was talking about before. I can use that little knife to strike this to start fires. This is mine from when I was a Cub Scout. I saved it. Still have it. I've had to replace this like 3 times though because I keep on using it all the time, playing with it. In here, I've got water purification pills. In this one, I've got matches and a match striker. In this one, I've got fishing line and 10 fish hooks and 10 sinkers. And I've got a flashlight. That's my little keychain survival kit. Yeah?
Would any of those things pass through airport security?
No, I've had them confiscated before. No. Maybe the key. It depends how much they're paying attention and if they've seen them before. I had this really cool one that I had on my wallet, and I went through the security scanner, the x-ray machine thing, and the technician stops it, and she calls like the manager over, they're both looking, and they're both going, I don't know. And they said, sir, do you have something oddly shaped piece of metal in your wallet? And I'm like, oh, I was on the way to Disney World and I forgot to take it out. I had this credit card stainless steel survival card thing with all kinds of designs on it or whatever, and they found that. And I'm like, can I at least like get off a line and I'll like try to mail it back to myself? I just don't want to like, you know, I don't want to have it be taken away. And they're like, no, you can't. We found it, you have to leave it here. And I'm like, can at least one of you guys take it then, maybe, so it's not going to waste? They're like, no, we have to throw it away. I'm like, oh, fine. So.
That's the wallet ninja, right?
No, I have that too. I have that too. No, it was, I might have it in one of these kits. I'm not sure. Is it in this one? Nope, it's not in this one. I have it somewhere. I'll try to find it after. No, it's cheap. You can get them on eBay super cheap now. They're like $3 now. Stainless steel survival card or something like that. This is an Altoids tin survival kit. I'm going to talk about little pocket survival kits now. All different ways to make these guys. This is just what I did. I'm not going to pull it all out because it takes me a minute to get it in there. But I've got razor blades duct taped in there. I've got matches from an MRE. Anybody know what an MRE is? Military rations. They give you water-resistant matches in those, so I keep them. I've got a much bigger ferrocerium rod. And I always take the handles off and I wrap it with duct tape because the handles pop off because they're epoxied in with junky epoxy. And this stays on as a handle. And duct tape is very, very flammable. You can use that as tinder to start a fire with. I've got magic relighting birthday candles. The perfect thing. Best thing ever. I don't know anyone else who does this besides me either. I'm like thrilled that I thought about this. I'm like, what kind of you use to start a fire that won't blow out? And I'm like, these darn things. My mom, every year, my mom will get me with these. And if you blow them out, they relight. It's like the perfect thing. If it's windy, you're trying to light a fire, one of these babies. So I've got two of them in there. I've got one of my ex-wife's sewing bobbins that I took, full of fishing line. So you're getting it. Exhibit A. Steel wool, great for starting fires. Got a little fishing kit in here. Got like 10 hooks, 10 little split shot sinkers. I've got a piece of a Bear Grylls survival knife. Worst survival knives ever. I'm sorry if you bought one too. Suckers. crappy knives. I ground it down with my bench grinder to make a little handhold. And I have this for a little tiny knife in here. And then the best thing in here, I guess I am taking it all out, huh? I can't stop myself. I get excited about things like this. This is another thing that I came up with that I don't know anybody else that does. I thought to myself, I need some way of water storage in here. And obviously you can use condoms. That's like the time-tested thing in survival kits. You use non-lubricated condoms. If you ever tried to use them, though, they're a pain in the neck. And they get holes, and they squirt out all over, and it's a freaking disaster. So I used to, like, have them, and I put, like, I have a clip that I keep in the kit, and I clip the top of it. That way I can take it off and not have to tie it. Because once you tie it, it's forget it. You're not getting it undone. So I used to clip it. And then I used to put it in my hat or put it in a sock. It's just a pain in the butt to deal with them. Then I thought, what else is small? I thought Ziploc bags, but those suckers leak. So, again, breast milk bags for my ex-wife. Hey, now we're talking. It's made for fluids, okay? They're great. Each one of these holds about like one Poland Spring worth of water in it. They're awesome. And I fold two of them up in there. And they're made to hold liquids. They're not going to leak on you. They're more durable than a Ziploc. They double seal. They're the bomb. They're awesome. And then I have tin foil folded up in there that I can unfold, make it into a little bowl to purify extra water if I had to. Any questions about the little survival kit? In the back.
How often have you had to rip one of these things out in your life? Use it, other than when you're out in the woods.
I haven't had to use this little survival kit before. Knock on wood, thank goodness. But sometimes if I'm out and about, because I keep one of these in the console of my car, I'll take little components out if I need to work on something or if I need it. Nothing serious, not like an actual survival situation, though. I'll tell you what, though. I carry trash bags all the time in the woods, too, because I used to bring them to pick up trash I'd find. But I was at Disney World, and it was like downpouring, and we only had one umbrella. And of course, I'm going to be a gentleman, and my wife in the stroller, and they got the umbrella. So I'm sitting there, like soggy, and I'm like, wait a second. So we're at Epcot Center, and it's like downpouring. And I go in my backpack, and I've got like a 50-gallon trash bag. And I ripped a hole in the top, and on each side, I put it over myself, and I've got like a poncho, like a ghetto poncho. And my ex-wife was making fun of me. She's like, I'm not going to be seen with you. Oh, my God. I'm like, I'm dry, though. What's the matter? And all the dads were like, yeah. And all the moms were like, ugh. Some other larger survival kits. I'm not going to dump these out. But this I got at the Army Navy store, stuffed with all kinds of goodies. You guys can look at it after if you want. This one I bought as a kit from Topps Knives because it comes with like one of the coolest things ever. And then I added to it. I made this little sheath. It doesn't come with the sheath, but this is called the Eco Hawk. It's a tomahawk blade. Yeah, ooh, ah. Then you would attach this to a stick with parachute cord that it came with it, and you can make it into a tomahawk or use it as a knife or whatever you want. And then I made this sheath for it out of an old boot the owner of the Army Navy store gave to me. And then I added things to the kit. And I used to keep this in my wife's car. So that's kind of cool too. It's all kinds of different size kits. And then you get up to like the whole bug out bag thing, which we're not going to discuss today. All right, how you guys doing? Good? Hanging in there? All right, so it's been about an hour. That's the gist of my basic wilderness survival thing. But then I've got some other things you guys can come up here and check out if you want. If you want, you guys can come up here. You guys can all come up and check out these tables. Hang out with me. Yeah?
What's the longest you've ever gone out with nothing?
With nothing? I'm a business owner and a father, and I was a husband, so I don't have a lot of time, so 2 or 3 days is pushing it. But now I have the possibility of longer. Because I don't have a boss to report to. Yes?
You mentioned you three-plant books.
Yeah.
Reference. Did you find any errors?
No, not in these. But the military ones and like I forget what they're called. Yeah, like the military ones you have to be careful of. They're not that good. But these ones here, these are some of my favorites. These are all wonderful. This one, this is by Wild Man Steve Brill. He's in New York City. This is like the Wild Edible Plant Bible, this one. This is the one to get, I'd have to say. That's the best one. All right, so thank you guys for listening. You can come up here, I'll show you some more cool things. Gather around the table. This is, it's a longbow, but it's a recurve bow. Yeah, yeah. So this is you, and it's backed by Rawhide from a roll kill deer on 95. Not gonna say anything else about that. That's probably exhibit B on the divorce papers, that deer. So. And then I watercolored it, and I polyurethaned it to look nice. Yeah, watercolor. That's why it's red. It's not blood. I like red. But this is really, really nice to shoot. It's a lot of fun. And I make things in, I make like bow and arrow and quiver sets. So this is the quiver and arrows that go with this bow. This is made from jute twine from like Home Depot. This, it's like 8 spools of this. And I wove it together. And these arrows are made from poplar with black walnut heads, and wild turkey feathers, also from a roadkill on 95. And then they're wrapped on there with dried deer tendon, which is called sinew, also from a roadkill deer on 95. Wow. So you guys can check these out. Just don't shoot anybody.
Is that how the head is attached to?
Yeah, the arrowheads are attached with the sinew. Yep, pine sap mixed with ashes to make epoxy. That's how you make your own epoxy. And then you wrap it with the sinew, and you have to chew the sinew, and it mixes with your spit, and then you wrap it on real tight, and when it dries, it shrinks, and your spit forms glue when it mixes with the sinew.
So the tab that's coming down here, that's also sinew?
The gray is the pine sap.
Oh, that's the pine sap.
So you kind of epoxy it in position where you want it first with the pine sap, okay. And then you tie it on tight with the sinew. The sinew is what really holds it on, but this also creates a transition. So it's not going from the smooth head up to where it hits the arrow shaft. Otherwise, there'd be a bump there. And if you shot something, it'll go into that point, and then it'll start to shatter. So this makes it a smoother transition, so it goes in and doesn't get obstructed. So if anybody else wants to see these, I don't know. I'll just lay them down here.
This other two.
Oh, okay. So these bows. This one's all wood, and it's the rawhide back and wrapped in sinew on the tips to keep the rawhide on the tips because I recurved them. I steamed the wood on a pot in my kitchen and I steam bent it, and then to hold the bend and to hold the rawhide down, you wrap it with the sinew, and that holds it all together. This one is more of a laminated bow. This is a $5 red oak board from Home Depot. And I laminated black walnut onto the tips to make recurve by adding wood for the recurve. So it's kind of a cool effect. And this one shoots very, very nicely too. And then this one is a hybrid. This is white pine in there. And this is PVC pipe. There's a technique. I have one video so far on how to make a very basic one. I'll do more at some point. But there's a way to heat form PVC pipe and to make awesome, awesome hunting weed bows. And so this is a hybrid, so it's half PVC and it's got the wood tips on it. This one's a lot of fun to shoot too. And then this is all PVC. This is called a static recurve. By static recurve, I mean the tips curve back, but the tips don't flex, they act as levers. So when you shoot this, it whips the arrow out slow at first and then it makes it go fast at the end. So it's a lot of fun to shoot that and they shoot pretty fast. And then that red and blue one looks like Superman. That's a working recurve bow. The recurve tips actually flex, and they help to catapult the arrow out. So you see with this one, when you pull it back, when you would release it, it goes slow, 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 and then it speeds up at the end when you let it go. So you can play with this. Just don't let it go, because you might break it or hurt somebody. You guys can check that out if you want.
Parachute cord?
Yeah, and for the PVC bows, I use parachute cord for the strings. They make pretty good bow strings, parachute cord. This one I keep in my car, that's why it's in a bag. This is a four-piece PVC bow that can fit in your pocket. And this is about 40-pound draw weight also, which is the minimum to hunt with legally in Massachusetts. This one snaps together. Which end is which here? I drilled little holes so I know which ends lines up where on it. So that's the bow. And then here's the, keep the string in here. It's a lot of fun making these PVC bows. There's a, what's that?
Have you ever actually shot an animal?
I haven't shot, no. No, I used to hunt when I was a teenager, but I don't right now. I might start to do it again at some point. But I just target shoot. I have old targets all over my backyard. Oops. It's been a while since it's been shot. But there's that one.
That's pretty amazing. They all slide out of each other when you pull back on it.
So the PVC bows I learned from a YouTube channel, a fellow YouTuber. He goes by the name of Backyard Bowyer. His name is Nick. And I have two of his books also. And he has like a huge YouTube following, and he does how-to videos on how to make bows. And I saw one very similar to that on his channel. I started making them. I made like three of those, and I gave two of them away to friends. But that one's really, really cool. It's a lot of fun to play with. Yeah, thank you. And then you just spray paint it.
Which one of those is the easiest to shoot for someone without much upper body strength?
Easiest to shoot is this one. This one. You can pull it back if you want. Just don't let it go, like I said. But if you make one this length, but don't recurve the tips, it's easier. It's easier to shoot it that way. When you recurve it, you make it shoot harder and make it shoot the arrow faster, more feet per second. So I'll show you some other things right here. I do a lot of blacksmithing, guys. I do a lot with railroad spikes. This is a tomahawk made from a railroad spike. Yeah. I love this one. And this is Coca-Cola wood, the tropical hardwood. This is a flint and steel striker I made from a file, from a wood file that I got at a yard sale. These are railroad spike knives that I blacksmithed in my backyard. And I did like a reverse twist on the handle, and then I wire brushed them. This is a different type of tomahawk blade that I haven't made a handle for yet. You can tell that one's a railroad spike. Tomahawk is different than an axe or a hatchet. They're a lot lighter, and they're like not as specialized as an axe. You know, axes are larger, they're heavier. There's a certain angle for the blade and a certain way to sharpen it, certain way to use it. A hatchet is a lot smaller, but also with the heavier blade. And a lot of hatchets have a on the opposite end, they have like a flat surface to use it, like a hammer to hammer steaks or whatever. Tomahawks, there's all different designs for a tomahawk, but they're a lot smaller, a lot lighter weight. They're more of like a lightweight kind of fighting weapon, but also for carving and for survival use, that kind of thing. They're just, the design's different. They're a lot more of a lightweight kind of thing to carry.
Do you also throw like
you could, I don't. I would, it takes me 2 hours to make this head, and then an hour to carve the handle, put it together, and I would be heartbroken if I threw it and I broke it, you know? Or even if it chipped it, I would be annoyed. So I don't. You could, but I don't.
What is this?
Oh, this is an arm guard. It's an archery arm guard I made from sterling silver. I went to a yard sale and I got an old sterling silver plate. I think it was a platter, actually. This is what I do with things I buy like that. I cut it out, and this goes on your arm, and it ties on the back with these. And that's so when you're shooting the bowstring doesn't whack you there and give you a black and blue. I use leather a lot of times for this, but this one looked really, really cool. This is one of the survival kits that I made. Before I show you that, I do a lot with cans too. I melt down aluminum beer and soda cans into ingots. These, I melt it down in my forge and I dump it in like a cupcake tin. And I make these, and now I've gotten all the extra stuff out that's not aluminum, and it's purified, and then I can dump these in my forge and cast them to make things. You can make bottle openers, you can make knives out of it, all different things. These I made my own pyramid fish sinkers out of aluminum. So just to give you an idea, about 40 cans makes one of these. Yeah. Yeah. So this one I used to keep in my camping trailer. I'll show you what I shoved in there. Steel wool, flint and steel, waterproof matches, everyone's favorite, magic relighting candles, a lighter and a Ziploc wrapped in duct tape. I always have my lighters wrapped in duct tape to start with, to aid in starting fires, rather. And
would you just pull off a piece of the duct tape and then light that?
You pull it off, crumple it up in a ball, light it, that's your tinder. Yeah. Yeah, the adhesive is very flammable, duct tape. And from the dollar store, I got one of these little water things. Got a $1 poncho, $1 Mylar emergency blanket. On sale at Bass Pro, I got a 2-pack of these little knives. I thought they were kind of cool, good for this kit. Little neck knife, a water purification straw. This is called a Frontier straw. It's got a carbon center. Water purification pills, these aren't that good, but I just wanted to use them, put them in something and not waste them. Those aren't that good. I don't like any of the water purification pills. The best thing for the water purification is if you have space for it, they're $30, they're called the Sawyer Mini. It's a little tiny filter. You can screw it onto a bottle of Poland Spring, you can screw it on a hose. You can do all kinds of things. It's very, very versatile. And the Sawyer Mini can filter 100,000 gallons of water, which is more than you'll drink in your entire life. And when it gets clogged, you just back flush it, and it cleans it out. It's got like this membrane like they use in dialysis machines. And so it lasts like forever. And they have a bigger version for $80 called the Sawyer, which does 1 million gallons, which is just an insane amount. Yeah. So I've got a little Gerber dime, little mini multi-tool in here. Ow. Fishing kit and snare wire for repairing or for making snares. 3 nails for working on projects. I can make arrowheads by chipping it with a nail if I have to. I can attach these with the duct tape onto a stick to make a trident spear if I wanted to. All different things to do with those. 20 feet of parachute cord. Got the aluminum foil to boil water, and my other favorite, breast milk bags, baby. You know it.
And they're food grade.
Yeah.
That's good too.
Food grade for babies. And then I brought this, I want to show you this. I was so excited I got this. I just made a major score at an antique shop in Rhode Island. I got this. This is made by the Ontario Knife Company. It's called a Rat 5. It's a really, really good knife I've wanted to buy for like 5 years, and I couldn't afford it. The retail on this is like 170 bucks. I got this for 55 bucks. Brand spanking new, never been used before. Good survival knife.
Now, why do you use the small, why do you pack these tiny knives?
Because they fit in the kit.
Yeah, but you're always going to have a knife. That was your number one thing.
Yeah, yeah.
So why would you even bother?
Because any knife is better than no knife. Any is better than none. Yeah.
What is special about this knife?
This knife is a really good steel. And the design is good. It's got a clip point design, so it's got a strong tip. The tip's not going to break off on you. It's got a good grind on it. You can use this to split firewood. You can use this for chopping. It's not that heavy. This is better for chopping, that one. But you can use it for chopping. This is a self-defense tactical edge. A pure survival knife would have a flat edge on that to use to like crack things with. This is more designed for whacking someone in the head if you don't want to kill them for self-defense or for breaking glass. But still good for a survival-y kind of knife. And the sheath is okay. It's got a MOLLE-compatible sheath. You can strap it on a backpack or whatever.
You sharpen all of them yourself, or do you have to send them out to...
I sharpen them. Yeah, I sharpen them, yeah. I'm not the best sharpener, but I try.
There's some art to
it. Yeah, yeah, and I'm not the best, but I get it done. And, oh, this is the first knife I've ever made. This is also made from that leather on the boot that I made for the sheath for the thing in there, from that boot the guy gave me. This knife is made from a file that I found in a shack that was being bulldozed across the street from my house. I took the rusty file out, I put that in my forge to soften it, and then I ground it down. And this is an American Tanto style blade that I made, which is more like a fighting blade, but it's a strong survival blade too. And I kind of saw back on the back of it. And then for the handle, I took all my old jeans that were tan colored for work, and this is called a homemade micarta. This is micarta, both of these, from the factory. They usually use linen or canvas, but you can use blue jeans for this, and you take your jeans or whatever, you cut it into little rectangles, and you take fiberglass resin from like Home Depot and the hardener, you mix it up, you dip it in fiberglass, lay one on top of the other, on top of the other, and you make like a sandwich of all the layers of your jeans, and then you put a brick on the top of it to weigh it down. When it hardens, you can use it like it's wood. You can drill it, cut it, sand it, and it makes these unbelievably durable handles. So that's the handle. These are my old pants, this handle. The blue jean ones look gorgeous. I have a few panels that I made from blue jeans at home. Then I have steel pins that I put through it to attach it. And then I just hammer the steel to kind of mushroom the edges out to kind of sandwich it all together. But this is really, really sharp. You guys see this scar in the back of my arm? Mm-hmm. I was working on the handle of this, and I had it clamped on my workbench like that, and I broke a drill bit, and I bent down to pick it up, and on the way up, emergency room. Yeah. I love this knife. Memories. That was like 2 a.m. I had drank 3 beers. And I go in and I'm like, I wake my wife up. I'm like, I need your help. I need you to duct tape my arm. She's like, what? I need you to duct tape my arm so I can drive myself to the emergency room. It was gross. It was really gross. But yeah, any other questions, guys? This is PVC pipe. Yeah, this is just a white half-inch Schedule 40 PVC pipe. Thank you. Thank you.